Blog Talk Radio.
Peace to the ancestors. Yes. Peace to Dr. Cornel West. Yes. Peace to the movement. Yes. We came from the bottom. Ever since they got us, we've been going through these problems. 400 years behind, and it's no promise that we gon' never actually be equal, to be honest. It's messed up how they put us in chains, kidnapped our language and changed our names. But when we speak Ebonics, then they call it a shame. They leave us with a couple options, rob or slain. Now we locked up again. How much can our skin take? We went from slaves to inmates, carrying the weight of the 50 states, working your forms. Black nannies carrying white babies in their arms. Black men sacrifice their lives in your wars, but you'll never show appreciation here at home. You treat us so damn wrong. You act like you hate my race. The police, they just beat us in the streets like an 808 base. America, when will you defend my case? You never will, cause your freedom is fake. I'm only living here cause I wanna get paid enough to round up all my family and shake.
Get up, 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 get up.
They done tore down all the PJs in my barrio. Gang units for worst case scenario. Still a couple of quirks, can't call it pancakes cause you pour some syrup. It's a whole lot bigger than a pretty new house, especially when the rodent's still running about. P. Diddy running marathons, racing dough. That's going to the school where the tax money go. Homeland Security now, there's a phenomenon. Pacifying folks by hanging Saddam. Troops still riding, still obliging, still no Bin Laden. Tuned in waiting for the president's announcements. No 40 acres. Take these 40 ounces. We ain't gonna get on the levees. Revolution televised early. Is you ready?
Why you wanna treat me so cold, America?
Lost your mind, especially when you done been down for so much time. Getting up don't even really ever cross your mind. You got porn shop, gun shop, liquor store sign, SWAT team, crack fiends, unemployed line. Stay late, dollar short, trying to buy time. What we do to survive is defined as a life of crime. You can't ball, then you forced to grind. If you fall, then you cross the line. And I've been putting in work from 9 to 5 and 5 to 9. Since phone calls cost a dime. What it made me is one of the relevant, highly intelligent brothers not only dealing with the same drugs. If I'm a hustler, then what's more American? We all founded on the same thug heritage.
America, why you wanna treat me so cold, America?
President of the United States, President Joe Biden, and making history for the first time in the United States of America, have a first woman vice president, a first black woman, and a first woman of South Asian descent, Madam Vice President Kamala Harris. This is an exciting program today. You tune into Dr. Mary Lee Live, 400 Years of Entrepreneurship. I'm Dr. Tatum from California. We have a great lineup. That song, America, was produced by Dr. Cornel West in 2007 on his Journey album. The first rapper was I Riz the Moment, my youngest son. The music was produced by my oldest son, Corey Tatum, out of California. And the second rapper was Rod Digger and Black Thought. And yours truly, Dr. Cornel West, closed it up. We've got a great program tonight. I'm going to be introducing the co-host as well as the executive producer, Dr. James Cannon, in a minute. But we're going to be talking about something very exciting on the Dr. Mary Lee Live Show. We're going to be dealing with reparations when Negroes, Black, African-Americans, and Africans. The questions will be tonight, will Mr. Tynes, when he get introduced, should Black Americans receive slavery reparations? When? How many? Why? Who owes? Those questions we'll be talking about tonight, about reparations. At this time, I want to bring to the podium this young man. I call him young man because I think I got him beat by 1 year, Dr. Cannon from California. He is the father of international entertainer Nick Cannon, and he is the producer, executive producer, along with Dr. Mary Lee, and the co-host. He will talk to you about the billion-dollar project, Incredible 400, the HR 1242, and what God has placed in his heart, and we'll be going into our show on the Dr. Mary Lee Live Show. I'm Dr. Tatum. Dr. Cannon, are you with us?
Yes, sir. Dr. Tatum, I appreciate you so very much. Dr. Lee, I appreciate you. Michael, to the whole team, I say good evening. You know, it is an incredible time right now that we're living in. Regardless of what you thought about the previous administration that just went out, whether you liked them, loved them, hate them, or didn't hate them, 4 years, ladies and gentlemen, have come and gone. And we put our best out there. And now as we switch, like God told Joshua, Moses, my servant, is dead. It's time to move on. Time to do some new things. Time to get excited all over again, ladies and gentlemen. And so that's the opportunity that we have tonight. That's what keeps Dr. Mary Lee ticking and kicking on this show, because of new opportunities. The Bible says that God's mercy are new every morning, ladies and gentlemen, that every time we get up, there's new opportunities. And Dr. Mary Lee is faithfully bringing that to our mind and our attention on her show every week, Wednesdays at 6 p.m., the Dr. Mary Lee Live Show. And as we go into our second season, we invite you to invite your family and your friends every Wednesday night and share with us as Michael opens up dialogue. And as we talk, ladies and gentlemen, about powerful conversations like reparations, some people say enough, 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 enough. You know, it's really not enough, ladies and gentlemen, because when there's a debt that's owed you on your job and you work for 100 years and never got paid, when you work for 30 years and never got paid, where if you work, ladies and gentlemen, for a whole week and you did not get paid, people that got paid tell you to stop hollering. People can't, that got paid can't tell you when is enough, when they've got their money in their bank account and they passing it down to their children, to their posterity. The American dream, ladies and gentlemen, was that you could come to America and get 100 acres of land for $10, and you could sell each acre for $3, and you could get all the slave labor that you needed. They put that cry out all across the world. They said, come to America, and you can obtain the American dream. And a part of that American dream was that you could have as many slaves as you wanted working out there in the fields for free from can't see morning to can't see night. 246 years of labor, sweat, and blood went into the grounds, ladies and gentlemen, went into the earth of America, building the capital was those Negro people out there working. So no other ethnic group, no other person can tell you to be quiet or shut down on this issue. You got to cry out like Christ said. If you refuse to cry out, the rocks will start crying out for justice for you. Ladies and gentlemen, we got a very interesting show for you tonight. I hope you sit back and continue. Call somebody. Get on this show. Spread the show. Hit the button. Click the button, like they say. But we're excited, and we want you to be excited. I got to bring to her platform Dr. Mary Lee. Powerful, powerful woman all her life, if she's encouraged people to be all that they can be. When I met her, I said, you got to go live. You got to power up. And it's been a successful endeavor, successful as it takes a whole lot of people to bring forth one powerful voice. And Dr. Lee is that powerful voice. And she's brought forth some other voices with her. And she's going to introduce them to you tonight. For those that's on the first time listening to the Dr. Mary Lee Show. Dr. Lee, are you with us tonight?
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Dr. Cannon. I certainly do appreciate you and great blessing in my life, and I appreciate that. Thank you, Dr. Tatum. Certainly, I love the way you open this show up, and you've been faithful. Everyone's been so faithful. Thank you. Thank you to our listeners, our audience, family and friends and new people who are on board. I appreciate you being here and listening, and our hopes and prayers is always that you learn something new and you come back. We're here, and I can say that financially we're sponsored by the Neighborhood Commerce Institute, which is a organization that I founded many years back during my working with entrepreneurs and through a nonprofit organization. My aim is always to help to bring people to where they want to be in life. True believer that whatever's on the inside of you that drives you, that thing that you want to do more than anything else is certainly your calling. And when I met Mr. Cannon, and he has this book out there. I don't know the exact title right now, but I know it's about your calling. And it was just like, wow, you know, he wrote this book. I believe in this. And I just think that God ordains things, and things don't just happen. You know, things don't just happen. In my life, I know that God is in every step of my life. And even things that come to us that seem to be adversarial for our good, and then we learn later on just why. And so, you know, so when I believe strongly in that passion, that drive, that thing that you want to do, and it seems like you're discouraged about feeling that, oh, how am I going to make money doing this? You just follow that because God put that in you, and I truly believe that that is your calling. My role is to help you to develop your vision, to develop your dream. This is what Neighborhood Commerce is about. We're about helping you to get your vision on paper, because when you want to get money for it, when you want to start something up, the funders, whether it be a capital, venture capitalist or bank for loans or grant, got to go on paper. And it's got to make sense. It's got to make financial good sense, and it's got to balance out. And then you got to have a management team. So what Neighborhood Commerce does, and most small entrepreneurs don't have your CEOs and all of these, this long list of management people, CPAs and all that. but we give you ours. We let you use our people. So we stand in the gap for you so that you can get the funding that you want and desire for your business, whether you can be a one-person operation. It does not matter. Matters no whatsoever. This is the power of collaboration, and this is what it's all about with us. It's all about the power of collaboration. So I certainly thank you, Dr. Cannon, for just being here and supporting, you know, all of this period of time. And then as we go forward in our second season, we're episode number 55. Like, yay, how do we get here? Next year, we're going to be episode number whatever it's going to be. But we're not going anywhere. You know, God is building this vision, this operation, whatever you want to call it. But God is building this. God is doing this. We're not doing it. And but through us, Yahweh is doing it. So I appreciate him so very much. And so if you're listening, all of our listeners, I want you to know that you can tap one. And for a question or a comment, your line will be open. You'll be acknowledged. You can ask your questions. You can, if you're not comfortable asking your question live, then you can also text your questions to 571-251-5193. And so we're just going to go on and get started with our topic right now. We're talking about reparations. We'll come back with some more housekeeping later. But I want to introduce Michael Tynes. He is a dynamic young scholar, you know, protege in everything. And so what Michael is going to lead us out tonight in this conversation. So you definitely want to take your pencils, your pads, your whatever you take notes with, and get ready for an awesome, awesome night of information. And feel free to join in at any time. Just tap one on your phone, and we will open up your line. Michael Tynes.
Yeah, thank you for that introduction, Dr. Lee. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, we can. Thank you.
Okay, appreciate that. Yeah, so as Dr. Lee said, my name is Michael. I personally operate as an advocate for global African independence and empowerment. I speak on African affairs, African history, and African people on behalf of the global diaspora. And as Dr. Lee said, this particular show is special given the fact that we're talking about something that's at the core of most African issues, really, which is the reparations, restitution for the labor extracted from not just Africans in America, but also Africans globally in other countries for, you know, toiling and suffering in fields and working for centuries without any payment for that. The exploitation of Africans is the most important issue that we can probably ever talk about. And so tonight, that's going to be the main focus of the discussion. I'm not going to say too much for any stretch of time. I'm going to give some context, mention some numbers and figures, and then I'm going to allow this to be hopefully more of an open discussion where people get to ask questions and people get to, you know, posit their comments. But to start off, I just want to say pretty much everyone here knows what the issues are. They know what the problems are. Now is a conversation about solutions, how to rectify some of those problems. And the main problem in America, speaking just for Black Americans, isn't so much that Black Americans lack ability, they lack aptitude, they lack competency, they lack tenacity, quite the opposite. If you look at the conditions of Africans, that Africans alone, no other immigrant group or no other non-African group have had to suffer equally, you'll actually find that Africans are the most tenacious group. They have been the most hardworking. So hardworking, in fact, they disproportionately contributed the most to the economic foundation of the American empire, the trillions of dollars that form the foundation of U.S. technological and political ability. The reason the U.S. has the ability to do so many things around the world is primarily because of the economic value extracted from Africans. And one thing to remember is you can consider, you can look at slavery as a 100% tax on income, so to speak, considering that what you make of value, whether it's the fruits of your physical labors or also the fruits of your intellectual labors, like inventions that your owners are legally allowed to take credit for because you're a slave and you're prevented from owning inventions or patenting your inventions, that economic value, the fruits of that physical and intellectual labor, is being taken in total. So 100% tax. In the modern day, you have many billionaires who have basically found the secret to getting a lot of money as fast as possible, which is exploitation, paying their workers a very low wage. As an example, Jeff Bezos, the owner of Amazon, formerly was paying his workers below federal minimum wage, and they had to go to the social safety net, to welfare. Meanwhile, he's the richest person, or was the richest person in the world. You can get that much money just by paying people low wages, but still paying them wages. That's not an uncommon thing. Most billionaires, actually, the way you make money as a billionaire is you have to exploit, economically speaking. You can be a millionaire without exploitation, but economically, getting billions of dollars requires shorting people. And that's just shorting people. So imagine what not even paying people at all would get you. Imagine how wealthy you'd be then. And then you'd have some understanding for how America got its wealth. How wealthy you can get just shorting people versus how wealthy, even much more wealthy, you can get not paying them at all. So with that in mind, and also with the understanding that that went on for centuries in this country, in fact, if you look at the actual dates, we can start from 1619 to 2020. That's a period of 401 years. As we know, explicitly, explicit slavery in the United States was outlawed or disbanded in 1865. So from 1865 to 1619, that's a period of 246 years. 246 divided by 401 is the majority of American history from 1619 to right now. Slavery was legal for the majority of American history from 1619 to this year. So this is a long-standing practice that extracted a lot of value. Now, how this relates to the modern day, it works actually in concert with other white affirmative action policies like Jim Crow and, you know, other things like the drug war that disproportionately targeted black communities. This works in concert with present-day disparities, primarily in the context of wealth. And in order to speak about wealth and give some context to where the disparities in wealth between African Americans and European Americans stands today, I'm going to have to rely on a lot of the brilliant work and research that's been done by a very, very a brilliant economist and researcher, William Dougherty Jr. Some of you may be familiar with the Dougherty piece. He writes specifically, primarily, and researches primarily regarding and about, you know, matters concerning the African diaspora, the economics of black reparations, and group-based post-traumatic stress disorder. And according to Dougherty's research, considering that African Americans currently possess around 2.6% of the nation's wealth, yet make up around 13% of the U.S. population, this is just one example of such a disproportionate theft of African American wealth. So 13% of the population, approximately African Americans make up, but only possessing 2.6% of the U.S.'s wealth. Now, to contrast that with European Americans, the U.S. as a union owns actually about 30% of global wealth. The trillions of the over hundreds of trillions of dollars in the world globally, the U.S. owns about 30% of that globally. And of that 30%, approximately 90% of it, of that wealth, is owned by self-identified white Americans. 30% of global wealth owned by just the United States. And that 30% of global wealth is approximately owned by 90%, or 90% of that global wealth, that 30% of global wealth is owned by white Americans. The average self-identified predominantly black household has approximately $800,000 or less in net worth than the average white household. about $800,000 less. There are also three white billionaires you can look to, Jeff Bezos, Bill Gates, and Warren Buffett, who can exemplify the significance of the disparity even further. Those three people, Bezos, Gates, and Buffett, are worth more collectively than 80% of self-identified black Americans who are at the lower end of the wealth distribution in America. Just three white people worth more than the collective 80% of self-identified black people at the lower end of the wealth distribution in America. 25% of white Americans, a quarter, have a net worth in excess of approximately $1 million. But only 4% of black Americans do. So 25 to 4. 25% of white Americans have a net worth in excess of $1 million. Only 4% of black Americans do. The reason why wealth is important is because wealth is more significant in income in terms of providing economic security and opportunities to more fully participate in society. Wealth also acts to offset and safeguard against the negative socioeconomic effects that follow income losses. Income losses that can be due to, you know, different things like unemployment or medical emergencies, what have you. Wealth can be used as well to better access higher quality education and, very important point, to better access debt-free education. Wealth can also be transferred intergenerationally to subsequent generations of individuals to bolster their economic security and well-being. And that's the key point here, the most important point about wealth, the intergenerational effects of that wealth, because one of the common talking points you see on most of the time, the more disingenuous side of the political spectrum in America, the American right wing Republican side, is that, and this is a sentiment that is actually echoed by, happy to say, the former Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell, when he said that, quote, none of us currently living are responsible for, you know, what America's original sin was, which is slavery. The reason why looking at intergenerational wealth is so important to debunking and dismantling that talking point of no one alive should have to contribute either directly or indirectly via taxation to pay for black reparations. The reason that's bunk is because people alive are in the position they're in America because of black exploitation. The trillions of dollars, like I said, that form the foundation, the economic foundation of the American empire, those trillions of dollars are what allow Americans to enjoy the quality and the standards of living that they have. Also, the socioeconomic disparities, the gaps between European Americans and white Americans, those gaps, most of those, I mentioned before, an acronym that explains most of that variance, systemic DOPES, D-O-P-E-S, differences in population density, differences in over-policing, poverty, environmental racism, and population size between these communities. Those gaps are primarily because of white affirmative actions that exploited and profit off of black exploitation, profit off of black people. So actually, on average, most European Americans alive do actually benefit not just from slavery, slavery, the economic value extracted from Africans via slavery, but also more recent white affirmative action policies like Jim Crow, like redlining, profiting off of getting an advantage, an unfair advantage, profiting off of making it illegal for other people to compete equally with you for the majority of American history, and profiting off of your ancestors, extracting wealth from that exploitation that they then pass down to you, that you inherit. So this common notion of, people alive didn't do anything back then, or, you know, the people today weren't the ones owning slaves. That's true, but it's irrelevant because the people alive are actually still profiting off of the socioeconomic disparities between African Americans and European Americans that were created expressly because of white affirmative action policies, in a sense, in other words, right? Regardless of, you know, how it makes you feel, whether it hurts your feelings, it's just a fact that white privilege is not only real, but it is the primary reason for the wealth gap. Remember, again, only one population in American history made it illegal, needed to make it illegal for other people to be able to compete with them equally for the majority of American history. In fact, if you want to go year by year, from 1619 to 2021, the year we're currently in, you can ask yourself, approximately as a percentage, what percentage of American history of time from 1619 to our year is characterized by just explicit white affirmative action policies, like, say, things that, you know, say black people can't do this, can't be here, or can't be this. They can't be a scientist. They can't be a doctor. They can't go to this university. They can't study here. They can't teach as a scientist at this university, a mathematician. They can't buy houses in this neighborhood. They can't go to this water park. What percentage of American history from 1619 to 2021 is characterized by those explicit policies? Well, the last of those explicit policies before, you know, you had the Lee Atwater implicit racism, Southern strategy style policies kick in. The last of those was done away with via the 1968 Fair Housing Act. And what the 1968 Fair Housing Act did was outlaw white-only signs. So very explicit displays of discrimination in housing. 1968 is less than 55 years ago. So approximately 87% of American history from 1619 to 2021 is characterized by explicit white affirmative action policies on the book. We're currently living in the 13% of American history from 1619 to 2021 without explicit white affirmative action policies. So another important point to take away is that reparations isn't just about slavery. It's about the entirety of white affirmative action policies that have intentionally led to a situation where Africans were made to not be able to compete equally to Europeans via governmental policy. So very important, not just to look at slavery, also to look at the entirety of white affirmative action policies. Now, that's enough talk about the historical context, considering most people here are already familiar with that. Most people here are already, they're already pro-reparations. They're already, you know, on the train for that. They're already pro-black empowerment and all that stuff. So we don't need to speak too much further on, you know, changing people's minds, because minds, in this conversation at least, most of them are already made up. Let's look at some ways in which reparations can be and is starting to be implemented. Now, first and foremost, I should mention that having the federal government, as many people are actually doing right now, you know, Daugherty, Claude Anderson, other individuals, having the federal government open in independent academic inquiry into the issue of how much of present socioeconomic disparities are caused by past and or current white affirmative action policies, be they explicit white affirmative action policies or implicit white affirmative action policies. That's great to have the federal government look into that and investigate that and find ways to actually generate funds to pay back restitution where restitution is owed. I should also caution that the federal government doing that is not going to be, or doesn't have the potential to be, as quickly as the state governments. You know, as an example, the state government of North Carolina, Asheville, in particular, the city of Asheville in North Carolina, they voted unanimously to approve reparations, reparations resolution for black residents. Now, there's still ambiguity as to how exactly they're going to do it, whether, you know, all the different options you have at your disposal, what they're going to choose, whether it's cash, whether it's tax credits, whether it's land, what have you, you know, whatever assets. Yeah, whatever assets they want to give out to people, that's still up for debate. But state governments like North Carolina's and another example like Illinois, the city of Evanston in particular, Illinois, have the potential to move much more quickly on this issue. And in the case of Evanston, Illinois, they actually approved using taxation of or tax money collected from taxing marijuana businesses in Chicago's suburbs as a means of funding a reparations fund to give out to black Americans owed reparations. States are likely going to move much more quickly on this issue than the federal government, but both, I personally believe, should be involved to most effectively foster policies that bring about meritocracy or bring the U.S. as close as possible to a meritocracy. So now, in the context of deservedness, I also have to mention before I forget, why this is needs to be specifically an African issue, right? That doesn't incorporate, or I should specify, when it comes to reparations, an issue of enslaved Africans and their descendants, and an issue of reparations, not just for slavery, but also for the wider affirmative action policies like those that came out of Jim Crow, why specifically the African-American community needs to be for African-Americans who are descendants of slaves and the African-American community in the more broader respect. The reason why that is, that specificity needs to be there, is because as much as, you know, exceptional anecdotal stories about immigrants, immigrant tenacity and immigrant, you know, fortitude and exceptionalism captivate the media and captivate people, as much as that may captivate people, as harrowing as those tales may be, those tales of immigrant exceptionalism aren't actually representative of what happens most of the time, or they aren't even characteristic of the socioeconomic conditions of most immigrants who migrate to the U.S. Going back to the first major waves of European migration, we have to remember that between 1800 and 1914, about 40 million Europeans migrated to the United States after the infrastructure of the United States was already built disproportionately by Africans. So these individuals and their descendants today benefited from the fruits of African physical and intellectual labors. So if anyone's wondering, no, immigrants have not had a harder time in America socioeconomically than Africans, and they haven't had an equally as harsh time in America socioeconomically as Africans. They've had it much easier, considering that they actually got to reap the benefits of the physical and intellectual labors of African hard work more than Africans did. They came in here and profited off of African labor. And tales of immigrant exceptionalism, even up until today, like I said, aren't characteristic of these populations of people who are coming here. For instance, people like to, in particular, people who try to detract legitimacy from the argument of reparations, like to cite Chinese people, Chinese immigrants, Nigerian immigrants, Indian immigrants who come here and do well in matters of, you know, academia. They do very well in elite colleges. What you have to remember about most of these individuals is that most people who immigrate volitionally, meaning willingly, can afford to immigrate volitionally. Most people who immigrate willingly can afford to immigrate. That puts you in a very different socioeconomic status than people who are already in the country, like poor African Americans being disproportionately poorer than European Americans. These groups of people, these Nigerians, these Chinese, these Indians, who are high performers in elite colleges in America and universities, are a very small sampling of their native populations. Nigeria has rampant wealth inequality and poverty. China has rampant wealth inequality and poverty, despite whatever the CCP, whatever propaganda they may try to tell you. India, of course, you know, most of India is significantly poor. So these aren't representations of hardworking immigrants. These are representations of people who are already either themselves or the sons and daughters of upper middle class and wealthy trust fund babies, so to speak. So make no mistake, this is not comparable to hardships that immigrants have faced, because, like I said, European immigrants came here and actually benefited more from African exploitation, African labor, than Africans did. And these immigrant groups that are supposedly exceptional are really just small samplings of their native populations, which aren't so exceptional by those same standards. To put it more simply, and maybe more harshly as it needs to be, because this is a very important issue, this talking point of immigrants, whether they're Nigerians, Indians, or Chinese people, you should expect more of this being used by disingenuous sides engaging in the discussion of reparations. So that's the reason why I'm speaking on it here, is because it's going to be an important thing to know, an important thing to have context for in the future. So to put it simply, immigrants flee hardship. Africans are born in it, molded by it, and overcomers of it. more than any immigrant population in the history of the United States of America, more than any could ever hope to be. Immigrants make choices. Refugees make haste, and Africans make do. With that being said, I don't want to drone on too long here. Does anyone have any comments, questions, and concerns before I proceed more so into looking at the actual economic value that slavery and white affirmative action policies like redlining actually provided to the U.S.?
Tap one of your phones if you want to make a comment or have a question. Our co-host, your lines are open if you'd like to go ahead and speak.
Is there anyone on the panel who wants to say anything?
Okay, so go ahead.
I can continue. So let me get more into the actual economics of slavery, and then I'll get on to Jim Crow. But for slavery to start, as I said, it can be considered
100% tax. I missed a caller here. Hold on. I'm sorry.
Okay.
510-4325. You're live.
Dr. Lee, this is Lyle. I'm sorry. Hey, folks, just happy to be on. I'm just curious as to everything that you're saying, I 1,000% agree with. And, I'm really looking forward to this administration being a lot more receptive to the language. If there ever was a person time when the conversation would be more pertinent, I think it's now. But my question is, on the heels of this uprising, whatever you'd like to call it, coup, it really shows the visible signs of just division in the country. Would we or should we expect some language about this, these reparations immediately, or would it be something that we look toward perhaps by the end of the year or by the second year? What's your take on that?
Okay, yeah, was that for me, Dr. Lee?
Yeah. I'm sorry.
Yes,
that was directed towards you.
Okay, yeah, that's an excellent question. So you should expect hearing a lot about reparations, not because you should expect white leftists or liberals speaking about it, but because Africans should go ballistic and push this, especially, like you mentioned, given what we just witnessed, which was an attempted white supremacist insurrection. And the main reason for it, actually, it wasn't it's not as economically grounded as a lot of white leftists will like to tell you. They'll say, well, it's just an economic problem. They're economically frustrated and they're poor people. These weren't really poor people driving from all corners of America to Washington, D.C., came with expensive guns and ammunition ready to, if you read the FBI reports, what they wanted to do, assassinate certain senators and legislature officials. This uprising mainly was because they know that this shift in power from the previous administration to the Biden administration, it isn't guaranteed that they're going to be as progressive as we want, but it's a lot more likely, probabilistically, that they're going to put forth some policies, given the pressure on them, that do things like make Africans much more easily able to compete equally with European Americans. And as I've mentioned before, when it comes to racism in America, the root of racism in America is just the fear of white people having to compete equally with Africans. And it is not exclusively Africans, but disproportionately their fear falls on Africans. So any time that they feel they're losing power, like what happened when, the votes came from Michigan, predominantly black areas like Detroit, and from Georgia, predominantly black areas like Atlanta, that gave Joe Biden the decisive victories, also in Pennsylvania and Philadelphia. This was a wake-up call to them that the black electoral power has grown to such significance that they can actually vote on measures to reverse the socioeconomic damages caused by white affirmative action policies and make Africans more easily able to compete equally with Europeans, which is what they fear. However, despite the fact that they're going to lash out more in the future, they want you to be afraid. that's why they're doing this. They want you to say, oh, we can't proceed too much further because they're going to get violent. You have to give them the opposite response and take every single action that they take in hopes of intimidation as fuel. I don't know what you want to – sure, turn it into anger even if you want. Just use that to propel you even further because they need to see that their actions of lashing out violently in fear of policies getting passed that make Africans more easily able to compete equally with European Americans, if they lash out more violently, they need to understand that that's going to be associated with Africans actually getting more aggressive and pushing for this. So, yeah, you are going to hear more about it in the future, and I think it's mostly going to be from Africans, not from Europeans, whether they're liberals or, you know, other leftists. So I hope that answers the question.
My question is the timing of it. There's just so much going on, and I totally agree with everything that you say. The then question becomes how and in what form does reparations occur? Grants for scholar, for college, money, 40 acres and a mule. You know, as a community, if you were to ask us what we would want, we would probably argue and fight over exactly what that means, simply because we all have different needs. But that's a complicated issue within itself. What does reparations
exactly
really look like? We've got to figure out how to define that to make it easy for them to get it done, would be something that I think should be commonly spoken about.
That's absolutely correct. That's an excellent question. You bring me to – I was going to speak on it, but you asked an excellent question, brought me there before I was going to bring it up. What I personally support right now is an open – independent academic inquiry into calculating how much of present-day socioeconomic disparities between the African-American and European-American community, white affirmative action policies like slavery and Jim Crow are responsible for. How much of the current disparities are these white affirmative action policies responsible for? And then once you calculate how much of the variance, so to speak, that those white privilege policies are responsible for, you put that into a fund, a pool of money. And after you put that into a pool of money, the reason why you need this to be an open independent inquiry is because this will be the time where the community will have to get together with the lawmakers, reach across the aisle, and actually determine, okay, we have all this money now. We calculated how much we owe you based on these white affirmative action policies, based on how much of your socioeconomic ills our policies or governmental policies are responsible for. Which avenues do you want to explore in terms of dealing this money out to, first slavery reparations for enslaved African Americans and their descendants, and also just African Americans in general because of Jim Crow? So we're going to have to get together after this open, independent academic inquiry is put together and the numbers start to come out as far as how much is owed to decide that. I actually personally am against – the reason why I mentioned things like cannabis – using taxation on cannabis as a way of creating funds, at least in the context of what people in Illinois were doing. The reason why I mentioned that was just to give an idea about some ways in which funds could be generated for this. I actually am not beholden to any particular means of doling out reparations like cash payments or land. I don't want anyone to be fixated on one. I want the open, independent academic inquiry to be had. And I really mean open, like tuning into C-SPAN to watch it happen open. And then once it's had, you know, I want the community to actually converse with the academics and say, okay, what are some of the multiple ways so we can be diversified, so to speak, I guess, in our portfolio in terms of the assets we're acquiring? What are some of the multiple ways in which we can do reparations by giving people assets that are worth the amount of money they're owed? Worth the amount of money that the black community is owed. I actually don't think that being so hell-bent on one way right now is a good thing. I don't think anyone should be exclusively for cash reparations, exclusively for tax credits, exclusively for, free tuition-free scholarships, education, exclusively for land ownership. I think you need to be open to all of them and wait until after the open, transparent, like C-SPAN televised, independent academic inquiry is had, before you make these decisions. But you're absolutely correct. We're not unified in what we want, and that's a problem. That's why I think we need this open, independent academic inquiry to happen so that people can tune in and actually get focused simultaneously at the same time, focus on the same thing, and start to come together with lawmakers and decide, okay, here's the money that we're owed. What are some ways in which we want to deal this out to people, whether it's, you know, paying for scholarships for Black Americans going into STEM fields like science, technology, engineering, mathematics. Hey, you get a full ride scholarship to Howard or to these other HBCUs, because we also preferably don't want to make – we want to make sure that we're not funneling this money into white institutions, right? We want to put this into the hands of African Americans as much as possible, but that doesn't just mean cash payments. That can mean other ways as well, like putting it into institutions owned by African Americans. So I take your question. I take your point. It's an excellent point. Appreciate it. It allowed me to elaborate on something that I agree with you with.
Michael, can I jump in and just go another side on that too, just in that picture more directly?
Yeah, for no problem.
Living in America all my life, and you know, watching what we went through as a people through the 60s, through the 70s, through the 80s, with the drug epidemics, with Black men, you know, struggling for jobs in America. You know, I think we're 1% of 1% of the wealth of America is owned by Afro-American people and Negro people. We own 1% of 1%. And as you made it clear, we work the soil, the ground we built in America. We should be the second richest people, not in houses, but in liquid money. Not we shouldn't be rich only in property. If the money is out there and it hasn't trickled down, then I think one solution would be we've got to build up the Black colleges that are staples in the community for over 200 years. So when a young man finishes college, if he has Negro descendant in his blood, then he should be able to receive a cash at graduation. Same thing at high school. We could cash our high school students out and our college students out when they graduate from high school or college. It would be a 20-year endeavor if we raised $1 trillion a year. If it's a $20 trillion debt, then when our high school kids finish high school, they would receive their first $250,000. When they finish college, they would receive their second $250,000. That would strengthen the historical Black colleges if we encouraged them to attend their undergrad in a historical Black college. If we're looking at the Black churches throughout the community, then they too can help and assist in getting our young people to graduate from high school. So then we strengthen the Black colleges and the Black churches, but we don't put cash in our kids' hands and let them blow it. We want them to go to high school and finish college. So high school graduation then would mean something very important to a young person. A lot of other ethnic groups, when they graduate from high school, they get scholarships and inheritance, and the only thing our kids get, they get nothing. So to a part of the reparations, pay them. Just like we get paid and we're excited about our paycheck, then our young people will finish high school. We will have no more Black, Afro-American, Negro kids dropping out of high school if they got a $200,000 graduation reparations check to do with whatever they want to do. They could go into college or open up a business, but once they finish high school, $1 trillion a year, we pay it out to our high school students. I think that would be a start, but we got to pay cash, sir. The cash is owed to us as a people. Those other things are important too. But what makes everybody excited when you're playing that Monopoly game is when you go around, you pass go, you get your $250,000.
Thank you. I appreciate that comment, Dr. Cannon. I have some questions because I'm interested in some of the proposals you put forth. So, as I said, I'm not opposed to cash. I'm just not set on anything yet because I want to be open to as many different possibilities as possible that are out there. And, you know, I worry sometimes, like, you know, when we had our conversation with Lyle and the folks from Red Rock Secured, and we were talking about the value of the American dollar and how quickly it can be devalued, that's just some of the reasons I have some reservations about cash payments in terms of how valuable the American dollar will be at any given time. I'm not opposed to it, like I said, but I just want to be as diversified as possible. So I'll ask you, my question to you is, when you were speaking about giving cash payments to black graduates, would this be something that you would consider for mostly like black institutions, HBCUs? Would it be equally split between white institutions and black institutions, or would it be just for like white Ivy Leagues? What would that look like to you? What institutions would that go to?
I would, having over 115 historical black colleges, I think it would be to our advantage to encourage the participation of Negro Afro-American children to attend their undergrad in a historical black college. Not so much what that college can do for you, but as an Afro-American Negro young scholar, what can you do for that historical black college? You can get your master's degree, but I think if we ask all of our children to let their alma mater first be at a historical black college, and upon finishing your undergrad, you would receive your second stifling of $250,000. If it's 40 million Afro-American in this country, $500,000 each would come to $20 trillion, something there in that range. So it would be a $20 trillion debt, $500,000 going to all Afro-Americans that have Afro-American Negro in their blood, then they would be entitled to that. You would first get your first stifling when you finish high school. Since we all matriculate through the high school system, that would be an opportune time to present that check at graduation. I would also say you're absolutely right. We don't want to devalue dollar. So I would think the best minds should talk about maybe we should get paid in cryptocurrency, or the best currency that's available at the time of payout. We don't want fiat money. We don't want Confederate money or money that's going to decrease in value. You're absolutely right. Pay us then in Bitcoin.
Do we know how many? Okay. You can jump in a lot, but while we're waiting you to do that, I just want you to think about how many laws are on the book for reparations that are not being currently enforced. So, do we work on those as well? And we also
to Lyle's point, we need to work on unifying. We need to work on unifying. We need to bring together the William Dougherty's and the Dr. Claude Andersons and having, instead of doing it so disparately.
Okay, so we have 269-30. Go ahead.
I think that we've created a bigger problem for ourselves. And what I mean by that is this. I'm listening to everybody speak, and everybody's point is on point. Why? Because it's your point. Why? Because you are a descendant of and entitled to. You recognize it, and you see it in your life because you see it was denied. You see others that have participated in the fullness of what we've created while we sit on the outside. But the problem that we're going to have, because I'm dead set against giving any money, and I can tell you why, we're not educated enough to manage funds. If the world knew that a young person, no matter how bright, was coming into $200,000 or having to make a decision about a substantial amount of cash, the sharks come out in another level of entanglement. It isn't that they aren't due it, but I think it should be something that they earn or that they have access to once they have shown that they have the, let's say, aptitude to be responsible, because you just can't waste. The other part of it is you can't give money to people with issues. We've got closet alcoholics, closet drug users, closet sex offenders, closet all kind of things that can be fueled by access to money. And without knowing the details about people, what you may want to be a good thing could turn out to be a really bad thing. And then you've got the pessimist who would be sitting on the side saying, see, the failed experiment. So it's the problem that I think that we have is that it's a complicated issue. My ideas aren't wrong and my ideas aren't right. They're just my ideas. Your ideas aren't wrong and your ideas. It's just we each of us as descendants deserve that, our own perspective. But to win this argument, if we could establish what reparations looks like in a 3-point comprehensive, and I say a 3-point because it has to be simple but inclusive. So it would require some scholarly weighed out thought. It would require
I think that the best mind in this conversation, if you look at the fact a young Afro-American come out of school with no money, no hope, and other ethnic group has inheritance, it has to be with money. To assume that we're not intelligent enough to be able to know how to handle money that's been given to us, that is true. Many young people, including my son Nick Cannon, can go to Hollywood and create millions of dollars, and the Jacob the Jewelers and the people that's watching this, they know these kids have a 4-year shelf life in entertainment, but they're going to make millions of dollars, so they seek to control that money, irregardless to what their parents think. They seek to control that money to get it out of the hands of the kids. But a wise parent wouldn't say, no, I don't want my kid to make the money. A wise parent would get wise counsel so that the child, even if they're going to manage their own money, they're being counseled properly. So I would say we have our kids finish high school, matriculate through college, so you're not just as ignorant as all get out when you get the money. But if somebody owes you back pay, if I owe you back pay, I cannot put stipulations on how intelligent you're going to spend this money when it's owed to you. I cannot tell you I'll give you this money if you go back to Africa, or I'll give you this money if you do this or that. Not when it's back pay, not when it's money that's owed because of work that have been done, which is reparations. White people understand back pay. You can't cheat us on back pay by telling us, we would give it to you, but you're not intelligent enough to handle this money, so we're not going to give it to you. Fooey on that. Give me the money that me and my family are owed, and let us figure out if we want to throw the money and flush it down the toilet. It's owed to us as a people. Give it to us so we can do what we need to do, and don't put no stipulations on what has to happen. Now, we as a people, Negro people, or Afro-American people, we do want our people to handle it intelligently. So just like I would get my son some wise counsel on what to do with his millions, I'm not going to attempt to give him directives if I don't know, but I can get wise counsel. And we as a people, we got enough black colleges. We've matriculated through these institutions. It's a $20 trillion debt that's owed to us, okay? Pay us in 20 years, raise $1 trillion a year, get the debt paid. In 20 years, Afro-American people have been thoroughly paid, okay, whether we blow the money or whatever. But no other ethnic group will ever respect us as a people if they know we wasn't able to get that $20 trillion and we stayed here for over 400 years. So, no, we have to get that money, And only way our young people are going to respect us as middle age and as adults when they've seen that we've got that money for them and we got it deposited in their account. Daddy, did you get the money that was owed to me, and did you get it in my account? The government owes our posterity $20 trillion. Our children are only going to respect us. They're not going to respect our education and all of our preaching and talking when they know there's a $20 trillion debt. We've been here. We need to march into those institutions with the best scholarly minds, like the Indian people did, like the Jewish people did, and get what's owed to our children so they don't have to face a world economy broke.
And this is
can
where
I,
our
can I respond to,
tit comes that, in. Okay, go ahead.
Could I respond to what Dr. Cannon said? So I agree with what you said, Dr. Cannon, and correct me if I'm wrong, Lyle. I think Lyle was just saying that he wasn't trying to limit anyone's personal responsibility or freedom or limit anyone's personal freedom as far as what they can do with the money that they're owed and that they're paid. He was just saying we should be aware of the fact that there are – marketers, professional marketers, financial professionals, just professionals in general, who,
Jacob the Jeweler,
as their job, calculate and analyze the spending habits of African Americans, and they're waiting like vultures to market to them and try to siphon that money off if they do get it. So we should just be careful about what type of ways in which it will be more easy for them to do that. If it will be cash, it'll be easier for them to do it with cash, but less easy to do it with, other assets. We should just take that into account. I think that's what he was trying to say, that we do agree with everything
Absolutely.
You're saying, but we should just be careful because, you probably know, being the son of Nick, that there are professionals behind the scenes who are calculating the spending habits, calculating what black people are doing with their money.
Imagine if you didn't get
It really boils down to the fact that everybody has a different – Mr. Cannon, to hear you speak, right, you have a family and a culture, and you've got your arms around things. You're completely different than a lot of other people that are out there. Some people don't have parents or have people – trying to educate them or slow them down. Some of our kids or some other people who would be eligible for this, and I'm not saying that we should not get the money. Absolutely,
right.
I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is that if we are to anyone, and this would be my advice in the line of work that I do, anyone, no matter how accomplished you are, if you're coming into a large sum of money, need counsel in this day and age, period. If you don't have good counsel, if you don't listen to financial people, if you don't understand trends or not know the market, you're $200,000 or whatever that a reward might be away from being taken. And so it isn't that we shouldn't get the money. That's not what I'm saying. We have to be prepared because the last thing we want is the rest of the world. If they know that we're getting some reparations, we need to be responsible. We need to make sure that we don't become the laughing stock, or what that was meant to heal hurts us. We become alcoholics. There's a lot of crafty people out there. So it's just wisdom.
I think you're
because
I think you're right.
Everybody's different.
Here's the thing. I think you're right, but here's the thing. We have historical black colleges spread throughout the United States. So we have institutions. If the Hispanic people had historic Hispanic colleges, if the Jewish people had, and they do have synagogues, but in through their synagogue, the money comes through and they regulate. So if we use our churches and our colleges and strengthen them through this reparation issue, that it's controlled through the historical black colleges. So they're going to get their money, but we're going to correct the curriculums in these colleges. We're going to have our kids to go through these colleges, so they're going to be financially sound and strong if we use the landmarks we already got. We got strong landmarks across this country as a people. We should be the richest people in the world with what we have, and particularly following the tutelage of what the Jewish people did with their institutions, and if we utilize the institutions that we have, the historical black colleges, the black churches throughout this country, and we make sure that our people are sound, if the Hispanic people had the landmarks in this country that we have, oh, man, they're already beating us up double time, but they would be triple time because they would organize through those institutions. We running from the landmarks and the institutions when we should be running to them. Our young people should be flooding the historical black colleges. Shouldn't be enough room for them. We should have to build new colleges every year instead of losing the colleges. What are we doing? We're going backwards. Okay, because we're putting our money in the wrong things, and we don't think we're intelligent enough to seize the means of production and control, but we are. I say let's use those black institutions. Let's make sure our kids get the money so they can open up their businesses out of high school or pay for their own college. You don't need no scholarship if you just got a check for $250,000. Man up and business up, and they don't need free college. If we make sure that they got a check, $250,000, and he going to get a second check when he finishes college so he can open up his business, that's what's going to put our kids head and shoulders. That's the reason they're going to go to high school every single day and get straight A's, because they know they got a check coming when they finish high school. And they ain't going to drop out of college either. They're going to go directly out of high school, directly into college, 4 years, 3 years if they can get it done, because they got a second check coming to them. It's a $250,000 check, $500,000 when you finish high school and college. That will motivate our young people. That will strengthen our historical black colleges and strengthen our churches. We are the most intelligent people, and our kids don't even want to go to college.
Thank you. Error code 269-3052. Want to let the caller chime in. You're live.
Thank you very much. I appreciate you allowing this opportunity. One, in the beginning of first, was talking about the historical context, and before your speaker, Michael had talked about the white privilege. But, you know, white reparations has been something that he mentioned. But, you know, it goes back actually with Lincoln. People always think about Lincoln and the Emancipation Proclamation. But Lincoln was also trying to give reparations to black slave owners if they gave up the slavery during his first term. And he petitioned Congress to give them, $325 per slave. But we also saw in 1865 where we had people who were white, who was promoting reparations for the enslaved African who was now set free, General William Sherman, who issued a reparation special field order, number 15, to provide land for the slaves freed enslaved Africans in South Carolina and in Georgia. And we know recently that in 1996, whites down in Florida, because they pushed the issue, the blacks brought the issue to the light of what happened in Rosewood, you know, they gave them a measly $2 million about the 1923 Rosewood Massacre. You know, we all know about a Black Wall Street. But even if you think about then, it's the same mindset that when Brigadier General Rufus Saxton was looking out, trying to look out for blacks and post-slavery, but it was the northern whites who came in and took the land from them. So when we look at the people who were supposed to have our interests, you know, there were some well-meaning whites like John Brown, but for the most part, the slaveholders have been white, they've been Asian, they've been Arab, and yes, they've been Hispanics. And that when we talk about reparations, we don't even take into the fact that, you know, we talk about the Jews over in Nazi Germany, but if you check, you know, the history books, and you know, yeah, Jesse Owens was there, but the records also show that Germany had over 6,000 mulattoes. In other words, 6,000 blacks in the Dachau concentration camp towards the end of World War II. And one of the fighters for freedom was a black man named Emmett Simmons. So when we look that we see that the American dream, the first American dream that was written down, was life, liberty, and the pursuit of property. Life, liberty, and property was original before Jefferson changed it, because the property was the African, was the enslaved African, what you call black, Negro, whatever. That's why the immigrants were being brought over here to manage, and if you were white and you came from Europe, you were given land and slaves. You were given land and black people to work that land for you. That was the American dream and still the American dream, because if you go again and look, that the Constitution says right now in 2021, and it's going to say the same thing in 2022 unless we change it, that the African is not a full human being. He is still three-fifths human being. Dr. Cannon is three-fifths human being. Dr. Mary Lee is three-fifths human being in 2021. And the 13th Amendment said that you are only free if you are enslaved African, a descendant of enslaved African, if you are not in prison. If you are in prison and jail, then you give up your right to freedom. That is what the 13th Amendment did. It did not free you totally. It only freed you if you kept out of jail. So when you're looking at reparations, you have to say that, hey, reparations were given initially to the white independents, white indentured servants, and that was called freedom dues. They were given to southern slaveholders. They were given money reparations, approximately in a billion acres of land. The Japanese got a billion in the four-point plan program, and then the Japanese also got more billions after in World War II from their internment camps here in America. And we fought Germany, but they gave Germany billions of dollars through the Marshall Plan. We know that the Jews got billions of dollars from Germany in terms of the Holocaust, and even though that we had 6,000 of us over there, the American Indians received billions in land, cash, and payments, public assistance, and we even, if you want to even get it more recent, you know, even the cigarette smokers now are getting compensated there, but no one wants to give the African American reparations. But the thing is, it has to be comprehensive. If you look at the things that Dr. Claude Anderson says, not only that we need entitled to land, we're entitled to medical services, housing, and economic development funds, tools and equipment for those that are doing trade, and in turn building building communities. But we also have to think about, in terms of education, it has to be tuition-free education for the 400 years that we've done. Blacks also need to be tax exempt for some period and even get a casino license. And we know that in 1866, the highest law in the land, the highest law in the United States, is called treaties. And the 1866 treaties, because the Native American, the Indian, sided on the side with the South and was one of the major slaveholders and the major slave capturers, that they kept the African trapped on the plantation because he couldn't run away, because he had to fear the slave catchers, which are called the police today, and he had to fear the American Indians, who were the slave catchers, and they would also get paid sometimes $25 if you even brought the slave back dead. So as a result of losing the war, staying with the South or staying with the Donald Trump side, that the reparations bill was put out for 1866 treaty, where the Native Americans, who were the major slaveholders, who were from Florida and North Carolina, because they lost the war, were forced to, and not wanting to give up their slavery, Andrew Jackson forced them out of Florida and North Carolina and sent them all the way to Oklahoma and these other places, because they would not follow giving up the enslaved Africans and sharing the land. So, and then they lost. So we have all of that going for us, as well as the Freedom Bank that's done, as well as the role models. But you are 100% correct that what happened down in Rosewood, what happened down in Tulsa, Oklahoma, was you had to get your black mind right. You had to be pro-black. You had to be unashamedly African, unashamedly black, and unashamedly pro-black. In other words, unapologetically African, unapologetically black, and unashamedly pro-African. That's how you build a black community. So you have to have that mindset first. Otherwise, you are going to blow it like it's been done today, just like you even have an example of that with the stimulus check, how it's been blown and people are being evicted even though they had the money. So we got to do another black power movement where we put empower the mind and increase the self-esteem to get the nigger out of them, to get the ghetto out of them, to get the hustler, the dope fiend, the prostitute out of them, the hoochie out of them, because that's what the social media has put out there, because the number two export of the United States is entertainment, and that's how black people are educated, whether you like it or not. That's how the world is educated to what black people are throughout the world. That's why the Black Panther, the people in Japan and China were upset. They asked the United States, are they niggers or not? Because the Black Panther was showing something different, even though Korea accepted it, those other countries didn't. So reparations, first we have to reparate our minds to get our minds correct, and then we do what we do need to be economically and put forward, because we are the only people who are not immigrants. We are the only people who are not immigrants. Every single other person is an immigrant, and they're also classified by the United States Homeland Security as white. Every Arab, every Japanese, every Chinese are all classified as white, and every Hispanic is classified as white, and every person from North Africa is white. So in the United States, you still have black and white, and so we cannot be foolish enough to try to be worried about everybody else. We have to first unify like every other group did, you know, Spanish the Spanish Congress and like the black the congressional group. The Spanish group told them that the blacks went to work with them, and they said, no, you guys haven't got anything accomplished in over 400 years. So the Hispanics are not working with them. So we have to make sure that we hold the blacks accountable. We have to make sure that we start building communities, because a community has commerce. If you do not have businesses in your community, then it is a neighborhood, because you have to be able to do that. So reparations require that we get the economics and we get the intellectual economics of the mind to be able to hold our money to make sure that money circulates. Jewish law says it has to circulate 11 to 12 times. Black people must have to do that, that we make sure that we have to spend our money in our neighborhood, because we go to Spanish restaurants to buy food, Chinese restaurants to buy food, and white people are not going to black people's restaurants to buy food on there, and we don't have a supermarkets and other things. So reparations mean that we have to build a total community, a total community with everything, where we can hire our own children and people and educate our own children and people. And what you have to understand is that the Howard University that you talk about, Howard University initially was only for mulatto, for children that were produced by slave owners, by black mistresses. So we had to make sure that we make the education on our universities to start with history, with Michael goes back 30,000 B.C. or 10,000 B.C., but we have to give a no slave history. We have to make sure the priority is what were we were before slavery. That's the first part of our reparations. Thank you.
Thank you. Erico 269. Okay, I do want to get
in the
other caller.
Before you bring in another caller, could I say something to that, because you made some excellent points?
Okay, go ahead. Yes, go ahead.
Okay, yeah, to the caller's point about, quote, you know, getting our minds right, I would ask to Lyle, because this takes me back to a point that Lyle made about simplifying our efforts and our intentions. And I agree with that. I think we should simplify into like a 3-point plan, if you will, to say that we want to solve the matters of lack of opportunity and lack of equal treatment in the arenas of health, wealth, and education. And as far as education goes, I think that would be, or that could potentially be a means of creating this mental filtration system where the people in our community, especially the young people who are going to get this money, if they're going to get this reparations, let's say, how would you feel about stipulating that they get this through going to college for, let's say, a particular STEM field, say things we need in the community, like engineers, like tradesmen, like plumbers, electricians? How would you feel about that intellectual filtration process being a means of, quote, getting their minds right while using the financial incentive of reparations to do that? Do we still have what? Or the previous caller can respond too. If I was just looking for some, just spitballing.
I think it's a debt that's owed, Mike. I think it's a debt that's owed. So if we can get them in college, I don't think we want to require what they need to major in.
No, I think that's an excellent point that you're making. That
go ahead.
You can go ahead, caller.
I'm sorry, I didn't know I was still on, but yeah, it was an excellent point that we have to make sure that we have a comprehensive program, that we have to understand that we are a damaged people, whether you like it or not, and if you say you're not damaged, then you're lying to yourself. So just a comprehensive plan We got a lawsuit on the federal court by Dr. Claude Anderson. So I think that we have to be comprehensive and involve the mental damage that we had because we suffer from post-traumatic slave disorder. And that's nothing to be ashamed of, but we need to know that we are mentally not in position to run a country yet, so we have to get ourselves in that position. Thank you.
Yeah, so Mr. Cannon, do you think maybe I was a little bit too and I didn't mean to suggest that we have to make everyone major in a particular field in order to get money if they're going to go through the college system to get the reparations. I'm just saying, how would you feel about using the reparations, some of it, just some of it, as incentives in an educational context for people going into certain fields? Like, let's say you get a certain amount of money if you, as a black person, go to college for this particular degree or that particular degree, whatever it is. This will be some of the ways in which you'll get your reparations. How do you feel about that, using education as an incentive for getting money, while also paying for tuition, of course, as well?
Well, absolutely, because I think then we can hold the institutions, you know, by their feet, you know, in their curriculum. We can look at it more critical. If we said to the institution, we're going to have 1,000, 20,000 new young people coming to your college, and your curriculum has to fit where their needs are. Right now, our kids are not, by and large, matriculating through the college system at a level that we would like them have. From what I understand, we're the worst-case scenarios matriculating through. So if we can have these incentives to get the kids to the college, mama can say, son, you know you got $250,000, but you got to finish college. What are you going to major in? Now, excuse me, at least we got him thinking about college, and we got him going in that direction. Now, if the college, from the college level, are doing self-studies on their curriculum so that they really – now we have to be – I think it will make all of us come to another level once we understand that the government is going to get behind us, pay the money out to our young people. We have the colleges, the institutions already set up. I went to a black college, and the black college I went to, it helped me because I was so far back. But it really didn't propel me. So I said to my institution, you might need to take out all the sororities and the fraternities and all that extra stuff that you're trying to keep up with and just be an educational powerhouse. Because in order to propel me, I know there's 2 million other young men that's behind me. And if you're not in a position, if you got me thinking about Greeks and fraternities and step dancing and I'm not studying, you got me on the basketball team and all this other extracurricular stuff, and I'm still leaving college half prepared, then, yeah, we got to make sure these institutions are doing their job. Stop playing with our kids when they come to your school and you halfly educate them. We're expecting them to come out sharper than sharp. So, absolutely, it gives us an extra reason to make sure these colleges are doing what they set up to do, sir.
Yeah.
Okay.
I also think that's
– Yeah. Let's get our next caller, 269-0566. 0566? Okay. There's no one there. Then let's get our caller, 313-4805. 313-4805.
Okay. Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay. I would just like to address the notion of reparations and the basis on which they may have happened, and you know where our people have come from. The Hebrew Israelites theory is true. And this has happened because we fell out with some supernatural forces, then The first order of business would be group repentance. Now, the peoples who encompassed this group are not just, you know, like they would try to say the tribe of Judah and North America or United States, 50 United States, but there's a large mass of people in South America, specifically Brazil, who have suffered. In fact, those slaves were sent to South America before the slaves were sent to North America. So you have a group of people on two different continents that share the same plight, speaking different languages. And this originated, the Arabs were the ones who initiated the slave trade. It then traveled through Northern Africa, and then there were some nations that accumulated around a group of people that caused them to matriculate over the transatlantic slave trade to South America, mostly, and then second to South America, the Caribbean islands, and then the 13 colonies. The nations that initiated these things were nations like Portugal, Spain, and other European nations. So if you want to address reparations, you have to go with the suit against all the nations responsible. Then there has to be the persons who were the claimants would be not just the North American African-Americans, but also the South American African-Americans. And then the claim would have to be based on what was the injury. Then you have to then explain the injuries and the damages done to these people. And then those assets set aside for that would have to be used to rectify the damages, whatever the damages are. Okay. Now, the main problem is this. What power exists to force any number of nations to come off of that level of capital and then to move on that and empower that many people? What power exists except maybe a divine power? You know, what power is it that can actually move on that and make those things happen? Because what you're doing is you're asking a Luciferian group of people to do the right thing, and you want to come with the moral high ground, and they may not be trying to hear that. They may not care. And, you know, just like what happened when the
– To answer that question directly, and you made reference to the first enslavement of Afro-American – that as Hebrew people, we may first need to repent. Yes, if what we're going to get is from God, then we need to repent before God. But America became the richest nation, the most powerful nation in the world because of our slave labor that we put here in America. America as a nation owes us. All the other nations of the world, we're going to let them pass. This nation called America that we're in, okay, that inviting all the other immigrants around the world to come participate in the greatness of America, they owe us $20 trillion. Now, we want God to help us get that. If you remember when the children of Israel left out of Egypt, God told Moses to go tell the people to borrow all the silver and all the gold. Now, God is God. But his method to get the wealth transfer into their hands, he said, tell them to borrow all the silver, all the gold. Go look at it. They plundered the Egyptians. When you look at the fact that God understands that we are here in America and we've been disrespected tremendously like no other group of people, but yet we still continue to cry out, we are climbing Jacob's ladder, we continue to believe the word, then God is going to assist us. After 400 years, the prophecy says. So if we know what we're asking for, now if we get sidetracked and begin to ask for knucklehead stuff, God said, tell the people to borrow all the silver, all the gold. Go look at it. When we tell the people here in America, You owe us $20 trillion wherever you have to go get it from. Pay us, and we will be the best American citizens in this nation. We've already proven we the best, and you ain't paid us. But when you pay us,
may I speak
we'll
on that?
Fix our own, we'll fix our own streets. We'll send our own kids to school, and we will be the best. That evil look that we got in our eye, that will be gone once they pay us the $20 trillion that they owe us. God is going to help us get it.
May I comment on that, please?
Yes.
Now, my position is this. Okay. If somebody steals your house and they throw you out on the street and they have their family in that house now and their family is doing fine, they took the deed. They took your deed. They erased your name from it. And they put their name. And you're out in the streets homeless. What argument are you going to give to those people to say, well, my family's homeless now, and we're starving. Can you please give us our house back? They're going to come out, and they're going to say, well, yeah, we know we took your house. We know that we put our name on your deed or your title of your house. But I've got these kids in here that I'm raising, and we're comfortable now. We're not leaving. So it's either you or me, and I'm going to choose me. And
well,
oh well.
We're not
see the issue. The problem is here. Dr. Kennedy. The problem is here. Who is going to force persons to put you in a more advantaged position than them?
Excellent
argument?
That's an excellent point, caller. I can actually respond to that. I can give you an answer to that because you raise an excellent question. And to your point about how do you essentially effectively bargain with people who are at least ostensibly amoral, here's how you do it. First of all, if they're amoral or they're seemingly amoral, you obviously don't try to appeal to their morality, right? You're going to try to appeal to their business sense. You're going to appeal to the fact that they want something that you can, you know, determine whether or not you can give them. So first you have to realize what you have to determine if you can use it effectively to bargain with them and if it's something they want. So you can exchange a little quid pro quo. Now, again, I'd just like to, you know, remind everyone this particular context of reparations is within the scope of reparations for Black Americans. So you mentioned, you know, something about folks in South America, and I certainly stand in solidarity with them. But also, we have to remember from our previous conversations, you know, I said that we can't really do anything about people in foreign countries as members of the African diaspora. The African continent can, and that's, I'm going to get to your answer about how you actually motivate these amoral people to do your bidding in a second. And it's particularly important that Africa is mentioned for reasons I'll explain a little bit later. But first, let me just say, we can't really do much about what's going on elsewhere in the world, Africans and other nations. We can just stand in solidarity with them. So this particular conversation is within the context of reparations for Black Americans or for African-American descendants of enslaved people. So,
okay, but can I amend my position? Because I don't think that you're understanding that South America is a part of America. The United States is a part of America. The thing of it is that you have Canadians. You have Africans in the Caribbean. You have Africans in Central America who are African-Americans. South America is America. And my point here is that, okay, if those original slaves were sent to South America in the 1500s, then the 400-year period has all long since went over. Now, you also have to argue when you make the Hebrews coming out of Egypt argument, the Hebrews were stuck in Egypt, or they were stuck in the desert for 40 years because they were not properly following the commands and the repentance necessary to get the divine assistance. Now, we know.
Right. Caller, I take your point.
Me,
I do. I'm just.
Okay, go ahead.
I take your point, caller. I'm just saying that regardless of whatever, like I said, I stand in solidarity with them. That doesn't really matter, though, because we don't have as much political power to influence those governments, right? We just have to get over the fact it's not the same government. So I do stand in solidarity with them, but we can talk all we want about, you know, what they're owed, and they can do the same for us, but we have to handle business here as Black Americans, and we can stand in solidarity with them, but they have to handle business there as, you know, whatever,
that's
they're
right.
Black South Americans. So in the context of what the topic of this conversation was about, which was
American reparations, okay, how do you motivate these people that you mentioned are seemingly amoral to actually do your bidding? Well, like I said, they want things. They want future assets they think that will be worth a lot of money. Africa, home base, so to speak, has assets. One of the important reasons why, or one of the reasons why developing Africa and Africans specifically owning as much of Africa as possible and distributing that as much as possible among the people, one of the reasons why that's so important, Africans controlling and owning Africa, is because they can bargain internationally and like, you know, use cards as in terms of the resources they have for improving the conditions of their diaspora. They can do that better if they were sufficiently developed Africans on the continent and in control of African resources than we can as African Americans. They can do that better for us. They can do that better for those Black South Americans and elsewhere. So it's not about appealing to people's morality if they seem amoral. It's about first finding out what you have, resources you have that are of value that other people want, and controlling that as much as possible so that you can use that as chips and leverage in a business deal. Now, I should also mention that that isn't the only motivation, resources that Africans have to giving Africans reparations, because you're like, okay, if I do this for them, they'll give me this resource, and I want that African, those African minerals. That isn't the only motivation. In the United States, I should also mention, I didn't before because I didn't want to muck this conversation up with too many facts and figures and numbers, but racism has actually been very costly for the U.S. When slavery was legal and you could just tax African Americans at 100%, so to speak, steal their labor, it was profitable. But now that you can't do that, discrimination against African Americans, resentment against African Americans, has actually been very, very costly. For instance, Citigroup calculated that about, you know, the U.S. has lost about $16 trillion, to be exact, in the sum of estimated economic losses from things like homeownership, education, and income and business investment gaps between Black and white households and firms due to discrimination. Because when you discriminate against African Americans in the modern day, and whether it's explicitly or implicitly, and say you can't buy a house here, I don't want those Blacks to live in my neighborhood, I don't want them to go to this school, whenever you suppress their potential to participate fully in the economy, you're robbing businesses of potential customers, and customers who, should they have been able to participate more fully in the economy, maybe would have had more money that they could give to corporations and companies, more money that they can use to spend on commodities and what have you. So suppression of the African-American economy via discrimination actually has cost trillions of dollars in losses for the American economy at large, because African-Americans cannot, the second largest racial population in the country, can't participate as fully in the economy, they can't buy as much. They can't go to as many places. They can't engage in the market as much. So the corporate America actually is self-interested partially when they're pursuing things like reparations for Black Americans, because closing these gaps is actually more profitable for the U.S. economy at large. So that's another motivation. You can play into that.
So Michael, real question. Would you say then the reason we've been handling it emotionally instead of intellectually? This is an intellectual conversation, and just the way you explained it, to explain it, if we go in emotional versus intellectual on this reparation thing, can you talk about the difference of us handling it emotionally versus intellectually? The Indians, the Jewish people, they didn't march in the streets. You said they handled that by treaty. That's intellectually. How are we missing it when we handle this question emotionally versus intellectually?
Yeah, that's an excellent point. So if you are going to make an emotional argument or an emotional appeal appeal to someone, you know, in philosophical circles, it's called making an argument from pathos. You know, you have your ethos, logos, and pathos. If you're going to make a pathos argument, an emotional appeal, you have to assume first and foremost that the person you're making the emotional appeal to have the same moral imperatives you do, meaning they have the same values. They believe in the same things. They value the same people in the same way. If, let's say, you want to convince someone to help a homeless person and they don't value homeless people the same way you do as human beings, that's not going to be a very effective way to persuade them in, you know, doing what you want. So you should make another argument, like, say, as I just did, which is, it's not just an argument, it's reality, that racism and discrimination that leads to socioeconomic gaps between African Americans and European Americans widening means African Americans cannot participate as fully in the economy. They can't buy and sell as much, meaning corporations, companies aren't getting as much of that money flowing through their pockets as they could be if African Americans were elevated socioeconomically. So it's in your best interest to lobby, use some of that lobbying power corporations have to lobby on the behalf of Africans so that they can participate more fully in the economy. You can make more money, and also you should, lobby in the pursuit of African quest for reparations, because some of those Africans, if you do their bidding, they may go back to Africa and maybe set up a certain situation where your particular corporation, your company, Amazon, let's say if you got Africans reparations because you put a lot of money into lobbying for them, they may set up a situation where your company is preferred, is given preferential treatment on the continent. Like maybe the continent wants to do business with your company instead of another company like McDonald's, because McDonald's then, help the effort of African reparations in America. So those are the type of arguments you should be making. And like I said, you should make them because those are more likely to appeal to more people, because moral arguments, emotional arguments require you first to know whether or not you share the same values as the person you're trying to appeal to emotionally. Whereas more intellectual arguments, arguments of mutual benefit, they don't. They tap into something much more universal than personal, subjective, emotional values, which is self-interest, which is self-preservation. So that's the importance. Okay, Dr. Lee, if no one else has any comments or questions, I can continue with some things I was mentioning.
Okay.
Well, I have a comment. May I make a comment?
No, we need to go on. Okay, go ahead. But we do need to go on, so make it really brief. We've got like 15 minutes left here, and I do want Michael to wrap it up. Okay.
My whole point is, speaking to the emotional appeal, I don't think invoking the spiritual is an emotional appeal, because what we have here is we have a body of individuals who has been perpetuating and unfolding great conspiratorial agents to suppress any development within the African-American community, not just in the United States, but in Central America and South America. It's actually worse for the African-Americans in South America. So you have a body of people who have been doing things like the Black Wall Street, Black Bottom, Rosewood, and these places that will simply not allow any cohesiveness or coming together for any advancement. They're just saying that there may be some type of a financial interest in persons doing that and trying to work on that. I think you'll just get more of the same. Who or what is going to force this body of people, whoever they are, whether they're Europeans or some other group, to move and act on any of this reparation? Who's going to be the judiciary agent that is objective enough to say, okay, now you must do this?
There won't be an agency to do it, but what it would be our people coming together as one in unity. We ourselves can develop and create and organize and plan and structure intellectually to force. We can ourselves can be that body system, the releasing or a viable plan for reparations. So we can prepare our own selves. But we as a people do have to come together. We're not negating the fact that the emotional and the mental damage is there. But we need to this is where our talented test comes in. So we have leadership within our own people who are very, very capable of organizing those. Once we unify to bring all the others along with us. So, Michael?
Right. I agree with your point, Dr. Mary Lee. To the caller's question, who's going to force? I would say, first of all, forcing isn't really effective. More so, rather, who's going to incentivize? I prefer that framing. And like Dr. Mary Lee said, well, Africans are primarily going to have to do that. But first, I keep trying to stress this, Africans have to know what they're worth, so to speak, or rather what resources they have and what they're worth. So,
right.
Like I said, this is primarily going to have to come from, yes, Africans globally, but Africans on the continent controlling as much of those African resources as possible so they can use those resources they know the entire world wants and yearns and lusts after as bargaining chips, not necessarily to force people, but to incentivize people. And to your earlier point about, emotional appeals and you saying that you don't think your particular spiritual perspective is an emotional appeal, I would say, to each their own, you can have your own personal beliefs. That's personally, I'm not disagreeing with, your ability to do that. But you have to remember that, self-interest is much more fundamental than different belief systems, right? How do you know if they have the same belief system as you, right? So you need to appeal to something more fundamental. Personal subjective morals isn't as fundamental as self-interest because people can have different morals, right? So you need to appeal to that, their sense of self-interest, their sense of, well, how can I benefit? You say, well, here's how you can benefit if you do this thing for me. So I wasn't trying to say that your spiritual perspective was devalued or didn't have any value. I was just trying to point out the fact that it is, it's varied. Different people have different beliefs, but most people are more unified in their common quest of the primary pursuit of self-interest, of preserving their own, health, wealth, and happiness than they are in some common agreement on some belief system or some moral system. So that's how you facilitate that change. Africans being the ones to incentivize those actors based on Africans knowing their worth and using their worth to their leverage.
Michael, real quickly too, if I could share that, if we look at the history of the historical black churches, my great grandmother was one of the first freed female slaves to be able to go to the colleges that were put together for the slave community so that they could get educated. So these colleges were set up to help us. So if we strengthen these colleges, from the colleges, the best of the minds that come out of the colleges, if millions of dollars and billions of dollars were given to the Jewish people, they would work through their synagogues to make sure that all of their people get paid. So we don't have synagogues. We have churches and we have historical black colleges. If you were speaking to all of the historical, the presidents of these colleges, what curriculum would you put forth for them to make sure so that the young men and young women that graduated from their colleges and institutions, if you had an organization to hold them to the fire to make sure that our kids coming out of their institution that's been set up for the purpose of the advancement of Afro-American and black people, so they're already, we don't need to build no institutions, we have them. But if we were going to hold the presidents of those institutions accountable, what type of curriculum would you be looking for? If we were going to get masses of money put in our hands and our kids coming out of school now with money, so the attention really now is on the curriculum and making sure the presidents of those colleges was charged right, how would you charge them? What would you say? What would be the curriculum?
That's an excellent question. So without getting into, too many specifics, because I'm not an expert on education policy, but I can give my personal general philosophy on education. As you said, we already have institutions. We don't need to remake institutions. We just need to build them up and fund them and tweak their goals in the curriculum. And the few main ways I would tweak the curriculum is put much more of an emphasis on things and professions actually needed in the community. So I will admit my own personal bias. I do agree with, teaching more African history before slavery, because that's important to get rid of that stereotype threat, those unconscious self-defeating beliefs that are intentionally, put into those more Eurocentric educational curriculum for the express purpose of subconsciously suppressing African self-worth. But my particular bias is more so geared towards STEM, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. So I would like to see a curriculum that focuses heavily on teaching practical skills necessary to be effective in different STEM fields. So teaching students how to do three things, what I call is bore it. Bore it is the most important thing to me. You got to know how to bore it, meaning you need to know how to B, build something, O, optimize something, or R, repair something. You got to know how to bore it. Don't worry too much about the papers, about the degrees, the certifications, and all the little awards. All of that that's peripheral. What you need to make sure is you have the knowledge necessary to actually be competent in your field. And what I think that the school should focus on to foster as much competency as possible is focusing on teaching kids how to bore it, teaching them how to build, optimize, and repair. What do you need to know to take this idea in your head and turn it into something in material 3D reality? What do you need to know to build it? What do you need to know to take this thing that already is built and make it work better, more efficiently, to optimize it? And what do you need to know to take this thing that is built but's not working right up back up to par, so to speak? How do you repair it? Those are the three things, the main things I would stress is, forgetting all the focus on all the stuff that I think is a distraction, like, the different awards, the grade point averages. You should just be focused on and caring about primarily, do they know enough to materialize their thoughts into reality, to build things, to optimize things, and repair things? So that's what I can speak on generally as far as what my, preferences towards education would be, because I can't get into too many specifics. I'm not like an education expert.
But I am. That was my degree. Build, optimize, and repair. What are we talking about? We're talking about entrepreneurship, period. We're talking about entrepreneurship. So my plan would encourage or infiltrate within the schools, not just college, but starting with preschoolers, teaching entrepreneurship. And you can do this with these little games that, they got the little cash registers, toy cash registers, the Monopoly games. I mean, all the different types of games that can be used in preschool, elementary school, and all the way up through college should be entrepreneurship, period. Because we were not made to work for someone else, but we were this educational system that we have, which is very antiquated, well, over 100 years now, was established to teach us to work for someone else, to teach us to be slaves to that 2%, 1-2% that's ruling the economy worldwide. And so we're still in this antiquated school system, educational system, what the white man wants to teach us. And so that we do need to get away from. We have to get away from it. And yes, they do owe us a check. They do owe us a check. And as Dr. Martin Luther King said, we're here to collect our check. We're here to get our check. And we're the ones who's going to have to demand it. We're the ones who are going to have to structure, organize, plan, come up with a way to cause them to listen to us. And repair ourselves within our own community, neighborhood by neighborhood. This is what we do have to do. And we can do it. We can do it. I have no doubt in my mind we can do it, because each one of us, we have talents. We have gifts. We have desires. And we can turn those desires and those gifts and those things that we want to do. We need to know how, as Michael said, to build them, to build, optimize, and repair through entrepreneurship. We've had a great conversation, and we really used up our time, but we're going to take a few more moments here to wrap it up. I don't know if Dr. Tatum is still here or not, but we do want our co-host to make some final comments here. So we will start with Dr. Cannon and then to Michael.
I appreciate the outstanding conversation. You know, looking at if the debt could be paid off in 20 years and we could raise $1 trillion a year, whether the government did it or whether corporations did it or we helped do it, my question to Michael was, what would be some of the logistics of realistically seizing, controlling, operating a lottery? You know, staying in my spiritual lane, as you know, in the gospel lane, but looking from a business standpoint, imagine if we own one in every state, and that money would jumpstart the pool. They could, if we jumpstart that pool to pay our people, and then demanded them to put into that pool, then you know, what are they going to say? No, shut it down. What corporation, what government wouldn't give to it? So my question would be, what would it take to really logistically control a lottery? Even if we did it from this, our small group, it could grow into maybe we control one. I'm talking about one in every state. But what if we just had one national lottery, black lottery, 100% of that went to that pool we talked about to start reparation?
Yeah, so I have to confess I'm not particularly economically literate as far as the success of lotteries and how much of a successful business endeavor they are for the people who own them. But I will say that right now, as you probably know, there is somewhat of a political stranglehold on lotteries as far as the kickbacks that lotteries, or I should say the ownership of lotteries as they're controlled by disproportionately, you know, Native American populations, as that's seen as one of the ways in which they were given reparations and owed reparations for whatever, you know, indignities they suffered. So I think at some point we would have to encounter that there's going to be perceived to be from them some encroachment on the ways in which they're making their money. So we'd have to, as a previous caller mentioned, go back into reparations treaties that the natives were involved in that stipulated that they were supposed to also give some restitution to reparations to Africans, considering that they as well were slave catchers. That's something a caller earlier mentioned. So besides that particular issue of actually consulting old treaties that Native Americans were, you know, tasked to honor regarding reparations they're supposed to give to Africans, besides that being a way to get into the lottery business, I think that you could look to states more so for that. I don't know if the federal government can really get as much involved in that. States to give tax credits or states to give, you know, equity to African Americans in lotteries. If African Americans, you know, went to those states, state governments and demanded for reparations to come in some of those avenues, like ownership of businesses, or ownership of any assets of worth. So, yeah, that's all I'd be able to speak on, at least tonight. And as far as lotteries go for black reparations.
Absolutely.
I don't know if Lyle is still here or not. But do you have any thoughts or comments about the lottery? I know your goal, Lyle.
I'm here. I don't know if you can hear me or not.
Yeah,
I hadn't really thought of it. Hello? Can you hear me? Yes. Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, I don't really have the lottery is something that's kind of I hadn't really taken that under consideration. I just, as I think about reparations, I think about why it hasn't happened. We know that there's overt, deliberate, systemic, I mean, every type of racism there is that's at the core of it. But now that we're letting our voices being heard, and the Trump administration has kind of open the eyes and ears of the world right now, I think we have a window in which we can pitch our argument or position and perhaps come out favorable. But I still believe, listening to all of the conversations and all the different points, that if we were to streamline exactly what reparations looks like, we probably would be in a better position to really win that argument or to make it happen. It has to be something comprehensive. It has to be something short and sweet. And it can't be too argumentative. The evidence is there. Your synopsis of, you know, the whole, how it all, just earlier today, is the argument. And it's indisputable. The question is always going to fall back on the execution. How are we going to do this? And that's the part that concerns me. We as a people, if we really in our generation, in our timeline, want to make this, get as much traction with it, I think that our biggest challenge is going to be defining that. What is it exactly? Is it cash? If it is cash, how is it going to be administered? You know, the point is, if you want to win, we've got to make it simple for them, in my opinion.
Absolutely, absolutely.
With these entertainers, they get their money for their residuals, for their movies, for their royalties, for their music. You know, it's a simple system. And again, I say we work it through the black colleges and let our intellectual folk make the demands that need to be made. We got intelligent people. It's an intellectual conversation. If our black colleges is behind it, okay, so, and we strengthen the curriculum, and then we speak the power. The United Nations did a 12-year report. Get the report that for 12 years they traveled throughout the United States, all the prisons, most people that haven't read the report. Once you read that report, we don't need no more studies. We don't need no more research. We don't need H.R. 1240. We've done all of that. That 12-year report, they have recommendations. The only thing they did not get in was in that prison down in Mississippi. We should go in and say we will conclude that report, but we need to get in that prison in Mississippi. Okay, they looked at all of slavery. They looked at Jim Crow. They looked at 100 years of mass incarceration in that report. It's on the internet, the report, the United Nations and reparations. They say pay Afro-American people immediately. It's well overdue. That comes from the United Nations. The United Nations funded the study, and then they took the study, and the United Nations they published a report. The working group published the report, and the United Nations Republic 2015. All we have to do is have our best minds take that report, march into Congress, march into Senate, and get what our children need. We marching in the street to get Kaepernick's job back. Come on, y'all. It's a $20 trillion debt that's owed to our children, the United Nations, and everybody in the world saying, why are we waiting? We burning down for what? But if we say $20 trillion disseminated out, $1 trillion as the kids come in out of high school, they get paid first. Out of college, they get paid. Pay the elderly people first. Each year, in 20 years, the debt is done. We help create it. There's 120 corporations, Wells Fargo, all these banks. They complicit. They know they complicit. They're going to wait till we die. They're going to wait till it's about 100 Negro people left. Then they're going to want to pay us. No, pay us now. Pay us in cryptocurrency. We don't want to get paid in dollar bills. Pay us in the most economic currency that's available to us, and we want to get paid. We want 50% of anything that got cannabis in it. How do we let them legalize cannabis right in front of us? And we don't get nothing. We're not demanding nothing. We need to say we want 50% of every medical that got cannabis, every experiment that you say you're excited about and it's going to make billions, Well, we need to step up and say we want 50% of it. That's what we should be marching in the street. Our kids are going to get hooked on this stuff. It's marijuana, but you can't study when you're a pothead. So our kids are going to be going to counseling. Our pastors are going to get wore out. They ain't going to know what to do. But we're going to sit back and let them do that in our community. And the only thing we're going to get is our streets fixed and our kids sent to jail for driving up under the influence. It's a billion-dollar industry, the lottery, and marijuana. I'm not for really none of those, but it's still a billion-trillion-dollar industry. We should be demanding 50% for the next 100 years. We was in slavery for 246 years. Then they can do whatever else they want to do with it after that. But we should step up and demand that. And then demand every young man that got get married out of high school or college, he should get a four-bedroom house.
I appreciate y'all. Bless y'all.
Thank you so very much. I love these ideas. And we know that people and committees and organizations are doing, you know, some things throughout this country. And we want to address, you know, here in this country what we can do. I think we should, you know, we talk, we have roundtables, and, you know, we have think tanks. I think definitely engage or organize some new think tanks and lead them out, you know, to form some new associations or some new coalitions to actually do some of these things. And I
Absolutely.
Am a doer, yes. Yes. Okay, and so, you know, I would definitely would be a part of that type of a leadership because it is time. You know, it's past time.
Absolutely.
And we do need to pull, you know, we do need to come together and bring our talents to attempt. And I think that this is the time to do so. I think that the environment, the country, the mindsets of our youth, and you know how that the resistance that we have amongst our young people and their desire for change is makes this the ideal time. So we're gonna let Michael wrap it up. I wanna say thank you to all of our callers and all of our listeners and our participants. I certainly do appreciate you. We are, next week, we're going to announce some new things that are coming. We have some new shows. This one's going to still be here, but we're going to be presenting with our same team live at some different times. So keep your you know, eyes on your announcements that you'll be getting. Those will be happening very soon. So thank you so much. Michael, do you want to go ahead and summarize your thoughts?
I'll say listening to everyone's addition to the conversation, and I certainly appreciate it giving me a richer understanding of the issue and more perspective or a wider perspective so you can look at it different angles or I can look at it different angles. And I'll just say that to Lyle's point about the need to streamline and unify and simplify the message as well as making sure it's full of substance that can be communicated, you know, intellectually, academically, and precisely. I agree with that wholeheartedly, 100%. That really is the only problem stopping us right now from achieving what we want to achieve. You know, we have the intellectuals. We have the know-how. We have all the economic calculations. We have the people, most of them, on our side who are already in agreement with us, enough of them to get this done. Now it's just a matter of coming together, simplifying the message of meritocracy. America's claim is meritocracy, so now mm-hmm. our argument should just be that we're trying to achieve that, and the way you achieve meritocracy, America, is by having an open, independent academic inquiry into the ways in which America isn't meritocratic, calculating how much of those gaps are caused by not people not being able to perform, but policies victimizing those people and then just correcting for that gap by giving restitution to close those gaps so you can actually create a meritocracy. So that's the argument. That's the intention. Now all we need to do is just unify. So once again, you know, I want to thank all of our guests listening for tuning into this installment of Dr. Mary Lee Live. I also want to specifically and especially in this case for this show, thank our guests on the panel for adding to the conversation and helping us promote a much more richer dialectic. And I'm sure everyone listening will look forward to many more conversations like this in the future. And just so you know, this was just a little introduction into this conversation of reparations in the context of Black Americans receiving reparations. We will be continuing these conversations, these types of conversations around reparations and some of the forms they can take in the future, as well as in much more specific details. This is just an introduction. So we thank everyone for listening and participating in this conversation with us to get the ball rolling. So, yeah, I want to thank Dr. Lee as well for providing the platform and allowing us to have these conversations.
Thank you so much. And I want to say to everyone out there, thank you. Stay safe. I love you. And until next week, Dr. Mary Lee Live, same time, same station. I love you. God bless.
Peace to the ancestors. Yes. Peace to Dr. Cornell West.
From the bottom, ever since they got us, we've been going through these problems. 400 years behind, and it's no promise that we gon' never actually be equal, to be honest. It's messed up how they put us in chains, kidnapped our language and changed our names. But when we speak Ebonics, then they call it a shame. They leave us with a couple options, rob us, slang. Now we locked up a game. How much can our skin take? We went from slaves to inmates, carrying the weight of the 50 states, working your forms. Black nannies carrying white babies in their arms. Black men sacrifice their lives in your wars. But you'll never show appreciation here at home. You treat us so damn wrong. You act like you hate my race. The police, they just beat us in the streets like an 808 base. America, when will you defend my case? You never will, cause your freedom is fake. I'm only living here cause I want to get paid enough to round up all my family and shake.
Get up, get up.
Might work till a couple of quirks. Can't call it pancakes cause you pour some syrup. It's a whole lot bigger than a pretty new house, especially when the road is still running about. P. Diddy running marathons, racing dough. That's going to the school where the tax money go. Homeland security now, there's a phenomenon. Pacifying folks by hanging Saddam. Troops still riding, still obliging, still no Bin Laden. Tuned in waiting for the president's announcement. No 40 acres. Take these 40 ounces. We ain't gonna get on the levees. Revolution televised early. Is you ready?
Why you wanna treat me so cold, America?
Lost your mind, especially when you done been down for so much time. Getting up don't even really ever cross your mind. You got pawn shop, gun shop, liquor store sign. SWAT team, crack fiends, unemployed line. Stay late, dollar short, trying to buy time. What we do to survive is defined as a life of crime. You can't ball, then you force the grind. If you fall, then you cross the line. And I've been putting in work from 9 to 5 and 5 to 9. Since phone calls cost a dime, what it made me is one of the relevant, highly intelligent brothers not only dealing with that same drug selling. If I'm a hustler, then what's more American? We all founded on the same thug heritage.
America, why you wanna treat me so cold? America, I done gave you all that I own. America, took me from my mama so young. America, locked me up and gave me your name.
America, 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 you know the Black Freedom Movement, Constitution, moral conscience, you know we've been trying to redeem. Even as a nation, they're trying to render us soulless, to wear our soulful people.